You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Dr. Teodros Avery. I'm the Associate Professor of Jazz Studies here at CSU Dominguez Hills. And today is the third session of the class entitled Key Movements, The Age of Jazz. Welcome. Today I'll be talking about African Americans who migrated out of the South to the Northern states and the Midwestern states. And we'll talk about the struggles of those people and what they went through, and also the motivations for the migration. Also, we'll look at important musicians such as King Oliver, Jelly Roll Morton, and Louis Armstrong. So let's look at a picture that really describes the migration. You get a feel for what was happening. Here you have a family, they're leaving out of the South. And you see there, they've got everything packed on their vehicle, and they are leaving the South for a better life up North. They even understand that these people were living in very intolerable conditions, that they were a few years, or say a couple of decades, out of the Emancipation Proclamation or the end of slavery. And so as they were leaving out of slavery, there became another system that was planted called the Jim Crow system or the Jim Crow laws. And so basically the Jim Crow laws were a set of laws that limited their productivity as a group. So you had in these states in the South, and especially in places like Florida, where it was actually part of the state constitution, to legally hold people back in terms of, you know, being segregated in public schools. Most public places, you'd have a black fountain, a white fountain, or you would have a black seating area and a white seating area. On public transportation, blacks had to sit in the back and whites sat up front. And then you had restrooms that were segregated. You'd had a black restroom, a white restroom, and then you had restaurants that were segregated. And so there was a whole system in place that basically said you have to live a separate but unequal lifestyle. And then we have some pictures where we have the white-only waiting room. So you see that's a sign from back then. But this is part of the law. We're going to go into the next picture. We'll see a picture of the colored theater. It was called the Rex Colored Theater. There we go, right here. So you see that was a black-owned theater that only blacks could attend. And then you'd have a white theater, you know, in a different part of town. So, you know, people have different ways of looking at this period of time. We're just looking at it. We don't really have opinions about it, but we just want to explain what it is. Then we go on to the next one. We have the colored waiting room. You'll see in a second. Oh, okay, we had that one before. And then we're going to have segregated water fountains. And you see, this is how specific it was. These Jim Crow laws created a situation in which neither group could drink in each other's fountain, or they could be arrested, beaten, or, you know, anything worse than that. So it was truly a system of inequality, and it was made to really keep the races separate. So this is what black people were leaving out of the South, that they wanted a better life, they wanted a fair education, they wanted to live in decent housing, and they just wanted to feel like they were equal. So it gives you some motivation, or it gives you an understanding of the motivation of the people leaving the Jim Crow South, or the South. And so another motivation, was violence. You know, there was a lot of violence coming from the Ku Klux Klan and different organizations like that, different hate groups, and people wanted to leave that. They didn't feel safe. You have to understand that at any time a person could be driving home or walking down the street and could be really confiscated as a human being and threatened with violence or rape or anything like that. So this was not a good lifestyle that they were living down South. It was very limited. They could not really move freely as American citizens, and they wanted out. So that is the motivation for the great migration of African Americans out of the South up to the North into the Midwest. So they traveled up the Mississippi River, or they drove cars, boarded trains, different things like that, to get away from this life that was there. Now, unlike life in the South, what you would find is that a lot of blacks who migrated to the North, they would see, for the first time, they would see like a black police officer. That was like a new sight for someone who had been living down South. They didn't see a black police officer. So you can imagine when they went up North and they saw something as simple as that, they were just like elated to feel like they were a part of society. You know, so that could really, really change a person's point of view of, you know, of a police department. And you see right here today, of course, many African Americans serve alongside Caucasians as well. We've come a long way. But during this time, it was not like that. So you had a lot of blacks that just wanted to escape that life. It was not a happy life at all. It was not a joyous time. You're talking about people who lived in constant fear of violence, or violence to their loved ones or their families. Okay, so we're going to now look at a documentary in which the people who actually migrated are going to talk about, actors are going to recant the writings of people who migrated. So they're going to talk about how these people feel. You're going to hear in the dialogue these people who traveled, they talk about what their impression was when they went up North, you know, going to Chicago for the first time, you know, arriving on the train in a train station in Chicago and seeing things for the first time and being really allowed to walk in any part of the town or any part of the train station. And that was a really big change for them, and a positive change, but one that was definitely well received and accepted by these citizens. So here we go. We're going to watch this this documentary called Up South, African American Migration in the Era of the Great War. Here we go. Let's check it out.
Why does the Negro leave the South? Indeed, you would feel a large part of the answer if you could be on this train, in this Jim Crow car, and share for one night the longing of these people to reach the line that divides Dixie from the rest of creation.
As soon as I got on that train, I felt free. Sure, I was sitting in the Jim Crow section up front where all the coal and dust rose up, got in the windows and ruined my clothes. But the chugging of the train couldn't hardly keep up with the beating of my heart.
Just behind us is a car for white people, where they can stretch out and rest their heads. They have paid exactly the same fares as we have. Some of these colored men are in the service of the United States, summoned from the far corners of Texas to fight for democracy in Europe. This is certainly a good preparation for trench warfare.
We were hoping we'd see the Mason-Dixon line. I thought it would look like a line of trees with some kind of white mark in the middle. Then someone said, the bridge ahead was it. We were north now.
In Chicago, there were no signs that said colored folks on one side, white folks on the other. When we got off the train, everybody went through the same door to the same waiting room. There was no sneaking in the back way to Chicago. The station was beautiful, but noisy and frightening too. Either you found someone you knew, or you went to one of the organizations that helped settle newcomers. Right near the station was the Loop, Chicago's white business district. And if you went east, it was all Lake Michigan, so huge it could be an ocean.
It was strange to pause before a crowded newsstand and buy a newspaper without having to wait until a white man was served. And yet, Because everything was so new, I began to grow tense again. I knew that this machine city was governed by strange laws, and I wondered if I would ever learn them. Richard Wright.
Dear Mama, when I got on the streetcar and saw colored people sitting by white people, I just held my breath. I thought any minute now they would start something. Nobody noticed. Now, you know I'm not crazy about mixing with white folks, but if I have to pay the same fare, I want the same accommodations. This is a real place for Negroes. I miss you terribly, Willa.
To my dear friend, if I had the money, I'd go back south and dig up my father's and mother's bones and bring them up to this country. I am 45 years old, and these 6 weeks I have spent here are the first weeks in my life of peace and comfort. And if I can't get along here, I mean to keep on going. But no matter what, I'll never go back.
Wow, so you really get to hear how much of a positive culture shock it was for these people to migrate up out of the South to the North. I mean, that last gentleman said he would have dug up, listen to what he said. He said he would go back, if he could, he would go back down South to dig up his mother and his father's bones and bring them up North. That's how positive that life was on him and his outlook and his feeling about himself. That he wanted to bring his deceased relative's bones up. So I hope you can get an idea of how important it was for them to migrate, the ones that did. Now we're going to look at another documentary. It's called The Great Migration, An American Odyssey. Now this one features real voices of people who experienced the migration firsthand. These are people who lived it, breathed it, saw it, felt it. So you really are going to get a firsthand perspective, an authentic perspective on what happened as they migrated out of the South up North. Here we go. Let's check this out.
Tell you, they really looked pathetic. They looked like they were just off the farm. Most of them, half of them, didn't have no suitcases. They just had big bundles, you know, wrapped up in a sheet or something, you know, clothes they traveled. That's the way they traveled. That's the way they came up. They was coming up by the hundreds. And that wasn't just one day, that was for year in and out.
Now you see, when we got ready to go, I bought a ticket to go on the ship from Jacksonville to New York. There were about a half a dozen young men like me getting ready to go. And a fellow that was at the dock, he walked up to us. He said, look, all of y'all can't leave here at one time because they won't let you go. He got all those men together. He said, now I'm going to take all you together at one time. And what they had to do at a certain time at the dark of night, they had to go to the outskirts of the city. on a railroad spur, and they had put an old raggedy car on that railroad spur. He said at a certain time he was going to be on that car. He knew when everything was ready. He was going to light a cigarette on the deck of that old car. And the men that was hidden, my father was one, they were hidden in the bushes alongside of that thing. When he lit that cigarette, all of them got right up and went and got in that car. And everybody was quiet, not a light or anything.
I beg you, baby, to treat me right. Now I'm going to leave you, honey, tomorrow night. I'll be gone, long gone, to never come back no more.
Well, I just long for the name of Philadelphia. I just love the name Philadelphia. So I accept to come this way.
So we had to go out there to get the train coming now. Now everybody, all of us tried to go. They didn't want nobody come and had a seat. We all got to have a seat, but the whole gang of them didn't have any seat, but they hid when the man come through the check-in, see. They would hide under the seat and like that, and that's the way we got away from there. And every big city to come to, they would cut off a car, you know, leave a car there. Like when they change an engine, they would leave a car there. So we found that out. So me and the three other fellas, we found that out, and we changed cars. So we got to the last car, and when the last car, they put us off at Peoria, Pennsylvania.
We were supposed to stay in that camp if you wanted to. If you didn't, if you could get away, you'd go on. And that afternoon, when we arrived here, me and two more fellows, we come on in the city. And we stayed at the Y for a while, down here on Christian Street. And I was there when I met this hotel man and got hired. And the next day I was gone. Didn't do much work that winter because it snowed the whole winter. It was snowing from Thanksgiving, snowed till March, every night, every day. That spring, I got a job on Hog Island. We were digging down in the muck. We thought we was digging rock, and it was ice.
So that was very effective. I mean, if you think about how those people felt, you know, leaving the South and going up North, and you can hear it in their voices. You can hear the elation and also the pain as well of experiencing that life. And that's very important for us to be able to hear the voices of the people who have actually experienced life during that migration. We're going to move on to a gentleman by the name of A. Philip Randolph. Here he is right here. He is known, and this is a direct quote that I researched. A. Philip Randolph was one of the most feared men in America by the Attorney General. He was feared because he was great at negotiating and achieving respectable wages and benefits for the train Pullman porters. These respectable wages helped the workers achieve a respectable wage, which eventually helped these families get out of poverty. And you know, for people who don't know what a Pullman porter is, basically it's like when these people would board the train in the area where, you know, in the Midwest and Chicago and these areas, when people would board the train, there would be someone there to greet you and they would get your bags. It's a lot different from now where you kind of get your bags and get on a train. No one really helps you. During these times, you would get to the train, Pullman porter would grab your bags, put them away for you, help you find your seat, then they would serve you. It was like being on a restaurant, but on a train, you know, at a full service, five-star restaurant, but on a train. So they would take your order, bring you a drink, you know, serve you food, basically pamper you and really treat you very well. But the problem was that these people, the Pullman porters, were not really getting paid well. They were not being paid a respectable wage. But yet they were doing work, which was, you know, it was quite a lot of work, and they were doing something that was very much needed. So basically they all banded together. They wanted a better wage, and A. Philip Randolph was the person who really organized and mobilized them so that they could band together to get a respectable wage for the work that they were doing. Kind of similar to how Martin Luther King mobilized people during the different boycotts, like the bus boycott, you know, and things like that in the different cities, Birmingham, Alabama, and places like that. So A. Philip Randolph was of the same level in terms of intelligence and also his ability to mobilize people. So we're gonna watch this documentary called Pullman Porters, Ordinary Men, Extraordinary History, and you're gonna get a real good education about what a Pullman porter was, how important they were, and how they were able to band together and mobilize to get better wages for themselves. So let's watch this.
They were ordinary men going about their jobs as railroad attendants, making beds, shining shoes, and cooking and serving meals. In the process, they achieved something extraordinary. They blazed a path for the rise of the black middle class and helped propel the civil rights movement in America.
Well, I was contacted and told that the Pullman porters were going to be honored in Oakland. I was kind of reluctant to accept the invitation in the sense that I was not a Pullman porter. I was the son of a Pullman porter, and I was the grandson of a train porter. So giving it second thoughts, I felt that there was a story to be told here.
Chicago industrialist George Pullman hired freed slaves in the 1860s as the first porters on his Pullman sleeping cars, known as rolling hotels. The Pullman porters, as they were known, provided high levels of service to wealthy travelers and became icons of an American era defined by glamour and rail travel.
My name is Troy Walker. My age is 90 years old. I work for the railroad for 37 years. I worked for the Santa Fe Railroad and also Amtrak, who took over in 1971.
By the 1920s, more than 20,000 porters and railcar attendants were working on U.S. railroads, making this the largest category of black labor in the United States at the time.
100 years, these remarkable individuals provided an unmatched level of customer service on trains across America, and they did so in the face of adversity and were unstopped by prejudice and a segregated workplace.
My driver was a dining car waiter at one time. I worked up as a lounge car attendant. Then in my later years, I worked as a supervisor of onboard services. I retired as an onboard service.
Most of my classmates were very envious of the fact that I had the job on the railroad, since at the time they were hiring only African-American workers for that position.
This was respected and dependable work that was available to black men at a time when options were limited by segregation and discrimination.
When I first went with the railroad, it was very prejudiced. It took a little time to change, because when I wanted to be promoted to from a waiter to a lounge car attendant, I went in the office and asked, could I get the job? And it took them a long time before they decided to give me a, and it wasn't that far better than a waiter.
Under the guidance of A. Philip Randolph, the Pullman porters were the first black union to organize. They had the audacity to ask for better benefits.
The porters effectively negotiated for better wages and working conditions for themselves and paved the way for improved conditions for fellow rail car attendants.
Both my grandparents and my father worked through the Depression era on the railroads and supported families. And as a result, I was able to go to school.
These positions of prestige within the African American community provided economic stability for porters and their families, allowing them a better quality of life and the opportunity to send their children to college.
When I started working for Boeing, I was working in their flight testing area. We were had taken our plane from Boeing to California, to the flight test center there at Edwards Air Force Base. And I managed to meet my father when he came in from one of his trips from Chicago. And I was able to pick him up and take him out to the test airplane that I was working on. And that was a moment I was proud of, and I think he was too, to know that his son was doing something that was far above what he had anticipated he would ever be doing.
You know, it's often said that without them, it was just cold steel, 8 or 9 cars or 10 cars or more, but with them, they gave the train soul.
Yeah, Pullman porters. You should know who they are, as well as other people, but you need to know what a Pullman porter is and how important they were and how important A. Philip Randolph was to their success and their struggles. Okay, so as we continue throughout this class, I'll tell you when, you know, I mean, you should already be taking notes, but I'll tell you when there's someone that you need to really be aware of. I won't always do that, but I will do it. And to the wise student, you know, jot that down, because it will come back in the form of a quiz or a test. All right. Now, we're going to talk about technology and how it was used to transfer the new sounds that were happening in jazz. This was technology was a very, very important part of the growth of jazz in America. You know, most times people only think about the performers, the instrumentalists, the singers. You cannot really get that music out without technology. And one of the people who was very, very important to that time in music is Thomas Edison. We all know Thomas Edison, and he's often talked about in a very casual way, but this man was really, really important to the development of a lot of different areas in technology and entertainment, but specifically we're talking about how important he was in music. Now, Thomas Edison was born on February 11th in 1847 in Milan, Ohio. His inventions included the telegraph, the phonograph, the first commercially practical incandescent electric light bulb, and the alkaline storage batteries that we use today, and the kinetograph, or a camera for motion pictures. These are all the things that he figured out how to make and had patents on. And without his technological advancements, life in the modern world during this time would have been drastically limited, and therefore jazz music would not have been able to travel around throughout the country as it did. Prior to phonographs, people would go to, say, a vaudeville show, and they would hear music. And so you'd have these traveling vaudeville shows. You'd have musicians, actors, comedians, dancers, all in one show. And they would travel around and you would hear the music. But if they didn't travel, or groups like that, if they didn't travel and you were in some city that was, or town that was not really a city, you really wouldn't be able to hear the music. How would you hear it? If all the musicians, all the great musicians are in Chicago, you know, New York, Kansas City, and New Orleans, and you live in a small town outside of one of those cities, unless you travel to the big city to hear that music, you really would not be able to hear it. So this is where this the phonograph created by Thomas Edison became a very, very important piece, because people were able to purchase phonographs and play them purchase the albums and play them on a phonograph. Now you could hear a musician any time of the year that you wanted to, and fall in love with a song or an arrangement that you really liked, or a singer's sound and style. You could hear them at any time of the year, and then you could hear them in advance of when they came to town. And then when they came to town, then you could go out and you could listen to them and support their music. So this this instrument, or this phonograph, really did a huge service, not only for the listener, but also for the musician, the artist, the traveling musician, the composers, the people who wrote the songs. Now their songs could be played anywhere in the country ahead of time. And then that, when I say the music could be played ahead of time, what that means is that now people can find out about you, and then when they hear you're coming to town, then everyone can come out. So suddenly, maybe only one person or two people knew about you in a small town. Well, if they're playing your music on a phonograph, maybe 200 people will know about you now. And then when you come to town, they can support your music, listen to your concert, enjoy themselves, and then you have a much, much larger fan base. These are some of the situations that the phonograph created for artists and for audiences. So it's very, very, very important to really check that out. Now, during this time, there were advancements in recording technology, which helped to make music popular during that time. I just said that, but I'll show you some pictures that will kind of give you an idea. We have the phonograph. There it is right there. We have the radio. The radio was also very important. Now you had a situation in which somebody could broadcast over this machine and let you know about different music that you've never heard. They could let you know about, you know, if an artist was coming to town. They could feature an interview, anything like that. That just changed the trajectory of how music traveled from the early teens through the 20s. Changed it drastically. I can't tell you enough how important this technology was to the spread of jazz and other styles of music during this time. Then we also have the player piano. Okay, that right there, that machine was able to play songs without a person. Now you can imagine, you could listen to songs that were programmed into that machine, and you could hear them at any time. Say your piano player is sick, doesn't want to come down to the bar because he or she is sick and just can't make it. Well, the piano player would allow you to hear songs, and then that would increase your business. It would increase the attendance at your bar or your restaurant, and people could still enjoy their dining or drinking experience and still hear music. That helped to make music even more popular during that time. Now, the next one that we were going to talk about is motion pictures. Motion pictures, along with the technology that Thomas Edison created to allow people to see motion pictures in a different way, or in a more modern way, also motion pictures could feature music by different composers. So you would have different people like Rodgers and Hart, different people from the American Songbook, from Tin Pan Alley. Suddenly their songs are being featured in motion pictures. So that one picture could draw, as you know, you go to a theater, you could be in a theater with 200 people and everyone could hear this song, you know, and be touched by that music and also be exposed to a new artist. and then they could support that art through that experience. Then the next machine we're going to show is a Victrola. That's the movie camera. And then we have the Victrola here, right? And this is made, actually, this machine was made by the Victor Talking Machine Company. Other brands had them as well. But this is an instrument that was used in middle-class homes. So that really changed. The cost to hear music had been brought down when the Victrola was made. All of a sudden, someone in a middle-class home could hear music whenever they felt like it. And, you know, so that means, you know, if you have a, like today you have a really large middle class. Imagine each house has cable, for instance. You know, we can all, or say a larger group of people can watch a television show that comes out on whatever, you know, whatever network, versus when people did not have cable as much. For the younger people, you probably won't remember this, but in the 80s, not everybody had cable. So the chances of a lot of people seeing a show on cable were less. Now that has changed because most people have cable. Same thing with the Victrola. More middle class people had a Victrola. Then they were able to listen to music whenever they felt like it. That increased the audience for an artist or for composers and stuff like that. So these are very, very important moments in technology, in recording technology, and also playing technology, machines that play music. And it changed and catapulted the sound of jazz in America. Now, next we're going to look at a man by the name of Jelly Roll Morton. There he is right there. Jelly Roll Morton, looking dapper in his suit and tie. He was born on October 20th, 1890, in New Orleans, Louisiana. Morton learned to play the piano at age 10, and within a few years was playing in the Red Light District, where he earned the name Jelly Roll. His style of music blended ragtime, music of the minstrels, and dance rhythms, creating a movement that would soon be called jazz. He's known to be one of the first jazz musicians to put jazz arrangements to paper with the song. So he's one of the people who was arranging. You know, in jazz you have performers, people who play instruments, you have composers, people who write songs, and then you have arrangers, right? Now today, most people do all three, but during this time, people didn't usually do all three. He performed, wrote songs, and he also wrote arrangements. Here's a song called Original Jelly Roll Blues. This was the first published work in jazz music, and that means that it was created for sale. It was duplicated and printed and then made for sale by different, made for sale to be bought by different piano players, right? Now, after living in Los Angeles for 5 years, Morton moved to Chicago in 1922. It was there that he produced his first recordings with this group, Jelly Roll Morton's Red Hot Peppers. So that group became very popular for him. Now, I was just visiting the Grammy Museum here in Los Angeles. And when I was there, there's an audio recording of him playing and speaking. It's owned by the Library of Congress, but they've licensed it to the Grammy Museum. And you get to hear him talk about different influences that influenced him, different styles of music, different people. He spoke about a teacher that he had during the time, who was a very, very talented pianist, and he was very influential on him. But he also spoke about the music of, you have to understand that Louisiana was once a Spanish, owned by the Spanish. So a lot of the culture in Louisiana is Spanish culture, especially during this time. That was before the Louisiana Purchase. So he talked about the influence of Spanish music on jazz, and he talked about jazz itself and how his style of jazz was different from other people. So if you get a chance, you know, for the people who just want to learn something and check something out, go to the Grammy Museum and check that out. It's, I believe, on the second floor. And it's in an area where they talk about the technology that we just spoke about. And then they talk about, they have an area where they let you listen to some of the first recordings that were recorded in the early, early part of the century, and by a man by the name of Alan Lomax, who's one of the first people to record music during this time with Thomas Edison's technology. But you get to hear Jelly Roll talk and speak about these different things. Now we're going to listen to a song by Jelly Roll Morton. It's called Boogaboo. It's from the 1920s. Now this is interesting. A lot of folks think that, they hear a phrase like, oh, a boogaboo, like she's my boogaboo or he's my boogaboo. And you might think that was a phrase from today, but that's actually a phrase from the 1920s. So what's interesting about this period of time, the 1920s, is that a lot of things in fashion, colloquial sayings, slang, even the way that people conduct themselves in society, a lot of that growth or those developments happened in the Jazz Age, So that's something that a lot of people don't really get. They kind of think that, what I'm a part of is from now. I'm young, I'm hip, and this is what we say, but I'm telling you, a lot of the things that you say are from these earlier periods, and this is one of them. Boogaboo. She's my boogaboo. She's always bugging me, that kind of thing. So let's listen to Jelly Roll Morton, Boogaboo. Now, what's important to note is that that sound that Jelly Roll had was a real New Orleans sound, but it was a sound that was not prim and proper. It was a what we like to call a gully sound. Gully. He's got that sound, you know, that real, you know, real street thing happening in his music, you know. Sounds like Jelly Roll's been hanging out, you know what I mean? And his music reflected that. Next, we're going to listen to a Jelly Roll Morton composition called Burning the Iceberg. This is a very, very good composition. Let's listen to it. So that was Jelly Roll Morton, and you get to really hear his sound. That was more upbeat type of composition, and upbeat songs usually are good for dancing. So I'm sure the people were dancing to that because of the tempo, you know, real good time kind of sounding song, as opposed to the other ones more of a slow drag or, you know, a slower song. So you really get to hear that he had a sound in which he could play very slow, very fast. He could play by himself. He could play in a variety of different situations to get his music across. Now we're going to talk about King Oliver. There he is right there. King Oliver was born in Louisiana in 1885. Though he started out as a butler, music was his passion. He started playing in a neighborhood brass band and quickly developed on his instrument in the style of another New Orleans trumpet player, such as Buddy Bolden and also Freddie Kephart. He was particularly good at freak music. This style involved playing with mutes to make the trumpet talk or to imitate animal sounds. So, you know, what in jazz, you have guys who play trumpet and they'll put like a mute over the bell. This is the bell right here, but you also have a bell on a trumpet. And so they'll put that mute, or they'll use a hat and they'll put it over the bell while they're playing. So it'd be like, whoa, 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 whoa. So they will call that freak music because it was just kind of freaky to them the way it sounded. And it would make these animal sounds. You could be like, wow, making sounds like that. And it would really change the way people felt about the music. He's also well known for playing the blues in the gut bucket style or the low down style. I talked about that just a second ago. This is a real gritty type of sound that he had. It was not a very polished and conservative style. This was a style that was meant to let you know he knew what was going on in the city. You know, he knew where the spots were to go play music and really be part of a social life in New Orleans. Now, he showcased these different aspects of his playing with his group, which was called King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band. Now, this is an important point that I want to make. Both were orphaned at a young age, and that I'm talking about King Oliver and Louis Armstrong. Now, King Oliver became a father figure to Louis Armstrong and really helped him in his career. He helped him how to be a better band leader. He helped Louis Armstrong really learn what it was and, you know, what he had to learn in order to be a working musician. And I can tell you, as a musician, if you're a young person that's out here trying to learn, you can go to school and you can learn what's in the classroom, and that's great. But there's a whole nother side to learning music that musicians will never know unless they spend time around older musicians. And that's what happened with Louis Armstrong and King Oliver. And that is that he hung around him, he learned what he should and what should not do, he learned what songs he should learn, he learned how to conduct himself and to be mature. You have to understand that Louis Armstrong at one time was an orphan, so he was, I'm sure, rough around the edges and didn't know exactly how to conduct himself so that he could get work, because a lot of these musicians, they're around, you know, higher society types of groups and have to know how to carry themselves, how to dress nice, make sure their shoes are shined, make sure their shirt is starched and ironed and all of that. And so Louis Armstrong was able to learn about that from King Oliver. And that's a very, very important part of learning the music. It's a whole culture in and of itself that you have to learn. And you just don't learn that from reading music books, right? It's almost like in sports, when you have these rookie athletes that go to a new city first year out of college, and then they start hanging out and get in trouble because they don't have an elder to say, hey man, check this out. Don't do this, don't do that, don't hang out here. Make sure that you learn this and that, and then when you show up, go here, don't talk to this. But you know, that's a part of the experience. And if you can have an elder tell you how to conduct yourself, you'll be a step ahead of the game. And that's why, part of the reason why Louis Armstrong was able to get so many opportunities at a young age and after having only played the trumpet for a few years, because he had people like King Oliver to really tell him how to conduct himself. Now we're going to listen to one of King Oliver's compositions, and this is King Oliver with his Creole Jazz Band, and the song is called Dipper Mouth Blues. Dipper Mouth, it's from 1923. Here we go. Thank you. Dipper Mouth Blues.
So Dipper Mouth, I'm thinking a dipper, you know, a dipper that you dip into the water, take a drink of water, you know, like a big spoon, dip it in the liquid, dip it in the soup, maybe they pull out some soup, or maybe dip it in the gumbo, if you know about New Orleans culture, you know, and take it out, and then you pour the gumbo in your bowl. In other words, somebody had a big mouth. That's what that pretty much means, I think, dipper mouth. So he was checking somebody out, and he said, check out this guy's mouth. You got a dipper mouth. A lot of the titles from this time, I'm not kidding you, a lot of them came about from just experiences like that, where someone saw something, and then they wrote a song. And the thing about the blues is one of those styles of music that is, it has a universal type of appeal to it, not only to the audience, but to the musicians. So you could write a blues and call it what you just saw, a dipper mouth, skinny leg blues. Maybe you saw a lady with skinny legs. You know, lady might have saw a guy with a big belly, call it pot belly blues. This is really, really, during the times when jazz was really like a blue collar style of music. So you had a lot of that kind of honesty in the lyrics and titles, and they would get right to it and just tell it what like it was, you know. So now we're going to listen to another composition by King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band. This one is called Riverside Blues, Riverside Blues. That last phrase that was being played on the composition Riverside Blues was a very common phrase. It says, doo be ba da boom ba be ba da boom. That's like a sort of like a popular motif that was really traveling through the music at that time. I can think of at least two or three other compositions and solos that I've heard from that period where that phrase was included. And so a lot of these phrases and riffs were part of a language a lot of times, that you had a language in the music, and these composers and performers would play that language in the music. And if you heard, say if another musician heard another musician play that phrase or that lick, then they knew they were of a certain type of musician and they were part of the clique. And with that, you knew you could trust them musically, right? Because they knew the language. Or maybe you needed somebody to come play a gig with you, you know, with your band. You only heard them one time and they played a lick like that. Ba-ba-bee, ba-ba-boom. And you say, he knows the language, call him, instead of the other musician who doesn't know the language. So a lot of the music is based off of phrases that people knew. It was a way to communicate a culture, right? And some musicians knew the culture and some did not. But the someone like King Oliver, he knew it. And that's why he is important to the next person I'm going to talk about, and that person is Louis Armstrong. There is Louis Armstrong right there. Louis Armstrong was born in 1901 in the poorest section of New Orleans. After an incident in which he shot a gun into the sky in celebration of the 4th of July, he was arrested. He was sent to a waif's home for orphans, or a boys' home. While at the orphanage, he began studies on the cornet. After 2 years, he became a promising musician. When King Oliver left New Orleans to pursue his career in the North in 1918, he recommended that Louis Armstrong play in Kid Ory's band down in New Orleans. So he left his gig, King Oliver left his gig with Kid Ory in New Orleans. And when he left, because he was grooming Louis Armstrong for a leadership type of role as a trumpet player. And when he left, he said, hey, man, I'm sure Kid Ory said, man, well, who should I get? Who should I get? I need to get somebody to fill your chair if you're going to leave this job. And he said, hey, man, get Louis Armstrong. And so that was a very, very important moment for Louis Armstrong, because it improved his ability to play quite fast, because he was playing on these river boats. And the river boats would travel up and down the Mississippi. And he also played with a group by the name of Fate Marabout, another musician. So he was playing with different people. He's freelancing. And King Oliver asked Armstrong to join his band as a second cornetist when he sent for him to come up to Chicago. Now, during that time, King Oliver had already established himself in Chicago and was working around. So then he sent for Louis Armstrong. Louis Armstrong went up. And then he started to get popular while playing with King Oliver. There's a lot more to it, but the two were featured up front, and they would play four-bar breaks, trading fours, things like that. And Louis Armstrong really began to progress fast. He was just really, really so talented at playing the cornet and the trumpet. But my point is, he had these opportunities that King Oliver was giving to him so that he could progress. And that's an important part of the music. You know, you play in these different situations with older musicians and you learn the language that the older musicians speak through the music. And then what happens is you end up learning the language and then you can pass it on to another young person. And it keeps going like that. And that's why jazz has lasted for over 100 years like it has. And you have musicians who know the language, some don't know the language, but the most important ones do. And that's very important. At Louis Armstrong's wife's urging, he left King Oliver's group to join Fletcher Henderson's band. And with that departure, he brought his advanced style of improvisation to New York City. When he got to New York City, his style was so ahead of other people in terms of how he played the trumpet and his language that he developed on the trumpet as well. He ended up influencing people on many different instruments. It wasn't just trumpet players. He had a style that went across instruments. And then eventually he influenced pretty much everybody up until the arrival of the bebop players, with people like Dizzy Gillespie and Miles Davis. So, you know, up until Dizzy Gillespie and Miles Davis, and Miles Davis in particular, Most people wanted to play like Louis Armstrong. That's how effective he was. That's how brilliant he was as an improvising artist, as a jazz musician, and as a trumpet player. Now we're going to listen to one of Louis Armstrong's most popular songs during the time. It's called Strutting with Some Barbecue. So you know what that's about, right? So you guys got his plate of barbecue, and he's walking to his seat. And so he's feeling good. He's going to get his eat on, as they say. And he's walking and, you know, feeling good. So he's strutting with his barbecue. So you can feel the energy and the excitement and the joy in this composition through that moment. Strutting with some barbecue. I'm about to eat this barbecue. It's going to taste good. So that's where it's coming from. Here we go, strutting with some barbecue. So you can hear that happy sound. This has got that feel, that New Orleans feel that he brought to Chicago and then to New York. Strutting with some barbecue. This next composition we're going to play is by Louis Armstrong again. This is called West End Blues, one of his more popular compositions that he wrote. So let's hear this, Louis Armstrong. West End Blues. Thank you.
wad 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 wad
All right, Louis Armstrong, one of the great, great American jazz musicians and entertainers, period, across styles. He was very influential on a lot of people in and out of jazz, not only in America, but abroad, around the world. And you have to understand that at the time, he was one of those musicians, entertainers that America was very proud to have, and so they would send him out on State Department tours. He was also invited to perform for different kings around the world, different queens, princesses, princes. He was that musician, that kind of artist that people wanted to hear. And he had such an international way, style about him, where so many people around the world applauded him in his great artistry on his instrument. Not everybody who played jazz was able to ascend to that level of respect and admiration by people around the world. We don't get it now because, of course, Louis Armstrong has passed on, but I'll tell you that he is one of the top 10 greatest American performers that the world has seen. Not only the U.S., but the world. There are a lot of musicians who are popular in jazz. There are not a lot of musicians who are popular who play jazz around the world. There's a whole different, it's like domestic success and then there's international success. Louis Armstrong is part of that international, or that small group of American artists that have total international success and acceptance, not only by music fans, but also by diplomats, and like I said, kings, queens, princes, and princesses. So he was a very, very monumental figure. Do some listening on your own, do some reading, just get to know who he was. At this point, I would like to invite anyone who's interested in studying music to go to our website here at Cal State University, DominguezHills.edu, or CSU, you see the address right there, csudh.edu/music, and try to find out about our program. If you're interested in applying, please apply. We're doing some very interesting things, and we're growing the program. Our director, Dr. Scott Morris, is putting things together that have not been put together here at this campus before, and I'm glad to be a part of it. And so it's a good time to be interested in music at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. Also, if you want to know about me, you can visit my website. My website is www.teodrosavery.com. There it is right there, and you see me playing the saxophone, and you can read about my bio, you can listen to different projects that I'm putting together and that I've released, And then you can also read my discography and check out what I've done. So that's teodosavery.com. And that pretty much concludes this session. Session 3, Key Movements, The Age of Jazz is the class. And want to say that it's been a pleasure to be here, and we're going to move on to session 4. We'll see you on session 4. Thank you so much. Have a good day. Bye-bye.